and welcome everyone. I am Nicolette Hume. I'm from the Adult Community Center here in Lake Oswego as their volunteer coordinator, but I also work at Providence. After reading Good Morning Midnight, I will say that we find ourselves asking the question of how have we lived our life and how have we taken care of ourselves? With that in mind, I thought of reaching out to Dr. Malia McCodrum, who is a part of Providence Integrative Medicine, and I thought that she would be the most perfect candidate to speak on this particular topic. Dr. Malia McCodrum is a licensed naturopathic physician and acupuncturist for Providence Integrative Medicine, and I will say that she's one of the only few practicing naturopathic doctors that we have within the Providence health system. She specializes in integrative oncology, supporting patients through all stages of treatment and beyond. And in addition to that, working with her cancer patients, she also enjoys working with specializing in women's health conditions, digestive issues, acute and chronic pain, and those who are really just seeking overall health and wellness. Dr. McCodrum's personal philosophy is she believes that all people have an innate capacity and to achieve a sense of well-being at all stages of their life. Dr. McCodrum is also a founding board member of the Institute for the Study of Loss and Transition, a nonprofit which is dedicated to the study of psychological aspects of chronic medical illness and palliative care. Dr. McCodrum also has a bachelor's in sociology from the University of Toronto, as well as a master's in oriental medicine and a doctor of naturopathy from the National College of Natural Medicine here in Portland. So without further ado, let us give a warm welcome to Dr. Malia McCodrum.
Thank you so much for joining me this evening. So as Nicolette said, we're going to be talking about lifestyle choices for graceful aging. So what does graceful aging mean to you? And I'd like you to take just a moment, think inside yourself, and what does that mean for you? You know, for most people, it's being able to do the things that they love and have it bring them joy, right? So whether that's going out for coffee with friends, climbing Mount Hood, playing with your grandkids, learning a new hobby, whatever that is, that tends to be what I hear in my clinic, what people want to be able to do. And it's the health things that get in the way of those things that really becomes the barrier to graceful aging. I don't think anyone wants this, right? Though I have to say that woman in the lower left corner with all of this, the pills, she doesn't look totally unhappy. Should I kind of question that? Because that's a lot of pills. But we don't want to, you know, we don't want to just be sitting on the couch all day because we're in too much pain to get up, just surfing through the television channels. We don't still want to be working, probably, most of us, unless it's on our own terms. We don't want to be in pain bedridden. We don't want to just be sitting there glumly next to our partner, right? We want to have joy. So hopefully, I'll give you some tools today through this talk on how to harness that joy and really live out the rest of your years joyfully and with some degree of vigor. Does anyone know where that is? It's the White Cliffs of Dover. And this is actually, I'm hopefully going to explain it well, but this is my analogy for living well through one's life. Basically, we are living our life up on that cliff, enjoying the view, playing with our family, enjoying life. We live our years, we get to 90, 100, you know, whatever the deck has in store for us, and we fall off the cliff, right? So until the moment we die, or very close to that, we are living well on the top of that cliff. This is what I call cliff medicine, right? We live well, we die. Not many people get to live that, unfortunately. So this is wellness over time, made this little graph, right? So the cliff medicine, those cliffs of Dover, that's the blue line. What most people experience is progressive, prolonged debility, essentially. So we do fine, we're 10 years old, we recover, right? We maybe sprain our ankle, we get better. We break our arm, we get better. Maybe we get really sick and go to the hospital and have our appendix out, we get better. But somewhere around 30 or 40, You know, maybe the second kid. You know, maybe the loss of a job, the death of a spouse or parent. You know, that illness we don't quite get back to where we were before. You know, maybe we go through menopause or andropause for the men. You know, things don't, you know, starting to get a little creaky, a little achy, a little bit more. Slowly, slowly, we start losing the ability to really enjoy our life fully. Maybe in our 60s, 70s, we start having to use a cane to walk, or we start needing lots of medications in order to live our life. Maybe we have a heart attack. You know, maybe you lose a limb to diabetes. I mean, there's lots of different things that can happen that can prevent us from living fully. So that's slope medicine. That's the kind of medicine I don't like to practice. I like to keep people up on the cliff. So honestly, what we're all looking for, I think, is longevity and quality to our life. Longevity without quality is devoid of something. And quality without longevity, well, that's just not long enough. So how do we get that, right? Has anyone heard of telomeres? A few people? Okay, so telomeres are kind of like, on our DNA, the little plastic ends of shoelaces, right? So our DNA, anytime we need to create a protein or a building block for our body, our DNA sort of unravels a little bit. We get RNA coming through. We get the building of a protein. Ravels back up. Every time that unraveling of the DNA happens, there's an opportunity for something to go awry, right? And the telomeres at the end, those little plastic shoelace ends, they protect the DNA from damage, right? Over time, we lose those telomeres. The telomeres specifically are a repeated TTAGGG sequence at the end of our chromosomes. The longer your telomeres, that seems to indicate a younger cellular life. The shorter the telomeres, the older genetically your body is. So things that can shorten your telomeres: living a sedentary lifestyle, being obese, eating a standard American diet. And I want to clarify here, the standard American diet is not just McDonald's, right? So we think, oh, I eat healthy, right? I don't eat the standard American diet, I eat vegetables. Generally speaking, a standard American diet, you can still have vegetables and still be eating the standard American diet. So it tends to be higher in fat, right? Specifically from dairy and red meat. Higher in carbohydrates, specifically from refined grains, so think packaged foods, and generally lower in vegetables. So anyone that's, I think the average consumption of vegetables in Oregon, which tends to be the highest consumer of vegetables, is still only 1.8 servings per day. Just not a lot. Not a lot. Especially when you actually look at a serving of vegetables, it's not that much. Chronic stress shortens telomeres. And stress is not just sitting in traffic on 217, right? That's stress, of course. But stress is also physical stress, right? So if you're a marathon athlete, there's a considerable amount of physical stress in your body as you're training. Changes in occupation. Retirement, surprisingly, can be a major stressor for people. It's a big transition, sort of figuring out what you're going to be doing day to day. Smoking. Childhood trauma, surprisingly, there's a lot of research going into childhood trauma and long-term health consequences of that, even if you're not traumatized as an adult. Early childhood trauma does shorten telomeres and lead to pretty significant increased risk of pretty much every chronic disease, including heart disease, dementia, cancers, all of it. And unfortunately, having a low socioeconomic status is also linked to shorter telomeres. And we think that's because the day-to-day stress of having to pay your bills and not having enough on a regular basis leads to chronic stress. So it's sort of a secondary marker. Things that can actually lengthen your telomere. So even if you have some of the things you're ticking off on the shortened telomere category, you can lengthen your telomeres today by exercising, by maintaining a healthy weight. So if you're overweight, losing a couple pounds, eating whole foods anti-inflammatory diet, and engaging in some sort of mindfulness, meditation, or yoga, some sort of relaxation activity. All of those things actually lengthen your telomeres. And this is all evidence-based, right? So they've done studies looking at individuals who are regular meditators, checking the telomere length at the beginning and the end of the intervention, and those telomeres, will they lengthen? So that all sounds fine and dandy. How do we do that in practice? Well, there's a cluster of places around this world where people live longer. And yeah, so they've got good genes, right? That's what a lot of people say. But we also know that people that move to those locations tend to do better as well. So one of them is the island of Okinawa in Japan. the Seventh-day Adventists, actually. There's a lot of research going into that population. And there's also an island in Greece called Icaria. And there was a New York Times article maybe 8 or 9 years ago called The Island Where People Forget to Die. And I think it's just a beautiful article. If you ever get the chance to read it, I definitely recommend it. So the story is about a gentleman named Stamatis Moriatis. And I apologize if anyone is Greek and I mispronounced that name. But in the 1970s, he was diagnosed with metastatic terminal lung cancer. In the 1970s, there really weren't a lot of good treatment options. So he decided, you know, instead of just dying here in the States, I'm going to go back to my homeland where he was born and was raised on Icaria. And I'm going to just spend the rest of my days, my short amount of days, on this island and enjoy myself. Well, a year passed, didn't die. I think he was given maybe 6 months or 9 months to live, right? 2 years passed, doesn't die. 5 years pass, still around. He actually doesn't end up dying until 2013, quite recently actually, almost 40 years longer than he was supposed to live, right? And the only change he made, because he wasn't actually pursuing treatment at that point, or aggressive treatment, was moving back to his hometown. What's different about this hometown? So I mentioned this, it's one of the blue zones. It's not rich. By far, most of the people there are quite poor, and they've got very little educational attainment as a population in general. But here are things that they do, and this is all quotes from the article. They take time to renew. So, quote, people stay up late here. We wake up late and always take naps. That sounds good, right? They move their bodies. Most Icarians work in family gardens every day. It's impossible to get around the island without climbing up 20 hills. Physical activity is woven into the fabric of daily life. So these people are not going to the gym, you know, and doing the weekend warrior thing, right? They're not training for elite sports. They're just moving their bodies throughout the day, every day, because that's just what they do. They eat differently than us. So their diet is rich in olive oil and vegetables. It's low in dairy, except for goat's milk, surprisingly, and it's low in meat products, and also includes a moderate amounts of alcohol. It emphasizes homegrown potatoes, beans, specifically garbanzo and black-eyed peas and lentils, wild greens, and locally produced goat milk and honey. They also engage with one another. So Icarians are constantly engaging with neighbors, family, and friends. When everyone knows everyone else's business, you get a feeling of connection and security. That was by Thea Perikos. Right? So everyone's up in everyone's business. So they're eating late, they're just popping by their neighbor's houses, they're drinking this special tea that they brew there, and they're gossiping. And it takes them, you know, a 2 mile walk to get there. That's how they're living their life. Great, right? Let's all go there. Well, that's not really realistic, right? We can't all move to Icaria, and it wouldn't work if we all did. But what we can pull from there are some pretty specific themes that we can start integrating into our own lives. So I call this the pillars of wellness. And I talk about this with almost every single one of my patients. So it's all about how we renew, how we move, how we eat, and how we engage. And there should be something in each one of those boxes that you're actively engaging in for your own wellness. So we're going to go through each one of those and talk about some tools to integrate some of those blue zone principles or the principles of Icarian living. So first, how we renew. So it starts with sleep. We all think of sleep as kind of an indulgence, but it's really not. It is absolutely essential for living well and preventing disease. So, and this has been studied in clinical trials. So everything that I'm going to be talking about today is derived from real world clinical trials looking at people doing these things. So lack of sleep is less than 8 hours. Who's getting right now less than 8 hours of sleep? I can tell you I am. I've got a 7-month-old. So this is one category that I need to work on. So lack of sleep reduces the strength of your immune system. So it makes it more likely that you're going to get that flu. Did anyone get the flu this year? It was a bad flu season, right? So getting less sleep definitely puts you at more risk of having that. It creates a chronic inflammatory state in our body. And we know that inflammation is a driver of so many diseases. You know, so we have all of the rheumatological conditions, like rheumatoid arthritis, ankylosing spondylitis. Inflammation drives those, but inflammation also drives a lot of other disease processes like diabetes, like cancer. Almost every single cancer, inflammation is a piece of that. Disrupts hormonal activity. So leptin and ghrelin are two hormones that regulate appetite and how we metabolize food. So if you're trying to lose that extra weight, yeah, eating well is important and moving is important, but making sure that you sleep enough is also really important to lose that belly fat. It also disrupts the way that we metabolize testosterone. So for all of you men who are struggling with libido, in your aging years or struggling to lift as many weights or just feeling weaker in general, lift weights. That also increases testosterone, but so does sleep. So it contributes to diabetes and insulin resistance. It increases obesity. It worsens cognitive function. So when you add this to a picture of obstructive sleep apnea, which is so prevalent these days, I have so many patients of mine that are on CPAP machines, or probably should be. And if you do have sleep apnea, I would definitely recommend that you wear your CPAP, even though it's not the most comfortable thing. But that the obstructive sleep apnea makes all of those things worse, because then you're not getting restful sleep. And there's other sleep disorders as well that can contribute to even worsening picture here. So how do we sleep well? Just give me sleep. So first things first, you'd be surprised at how many people are not doing this. Sleep at night. If you're a shift worker, I know it's really, really hard. I talk to a lot of people that are shift workers and how to essentially create nighttime when it's daytime. When it's night, that absence of the blue part of the spectrum stimulates melatonin production, which allows our bodies to fall into a restful sleep. So sleep at night when it's dark outside. Keep your bedroom dark, cool, and quiet. That also helps to calm the central nervous system and get that melatonin release happening. Another thing that can be helpful for those of you that are waking up frequently, especially around like the 2 to 3 a.m. mark and have difficulty falling back asleep, have a high-protein snack before you go to bed. Or even just keep a high-protein snack by your bed to have when you wake up at 2 or 3, especially if you have trouble getting back to sleep. So what happens is we have this beautiful relationship with melatonin and cortisol. So when melatonin's high at night, cortisol is low. And when cortisol is high in the morning, melatonin's low. Cortisol is released for a number of reasons. One of them is just being morning time. Cortisol is going to be released. Another reason cortisol gets released is when we're stressed out. So if we're stressed out trying to get to sleep, it's going to suppress melatonin production. Another reason why cortisol gets released is if our blood sugar goes too low. So if we're having a Thanksgiving dinner with lots of mashed potatoes and stuffing shortly before bed, all of those things are fairly high in carbohydrates. So we get this really beautiful surge in blood sugar, right? And then insulin gets released and then it drives the sugar into our cells and blood sugar crashes. So the body does not like that big ebbs and flows in blood sugar. So it stimulates the adrenal glands to release cortisol, which tells the liver to make new blood sugar. Which is great if we want to keep our blood sugar nice and even, which is really, really important. But it's not so great if we're trying to sleep, right? So sometimes, especially having a high carbohydrate dinner or a glass of wine before bed, which is quite high in sugar, or, you know, a glass of beer, whatever it may be, or dessert. I mean, the worst time to eat dessert is before bed. If you're going to eat dessert, definitely eat it with dinner and have it be a high protein dinner. But having a protein snack before bed stabilizes blood sugar overnight, so it's not allowed to go too low, and can subtly decrease that surge in cortisol around 2 or 3 a.m. So I often have people, before I talk about sleep aids, even herbal sleep aids, try out a high protein snack before bed, and I would say about 6 out of 10 of them say, yeah, I don't have issues with sleep anymore. So avoid screen time before bed. That includes TVs, computers, e-readers, and smartphones. If you are going to use those, make sure, I mean, it's pretty great. My iPhone now is pretty pleased to find out it's got this thing called Night Shift, where it makes everything look really yellow on your screen. That's really important. So if you are going to use your phone anytime between 2 hours before bed and bed, make sure it's on Night Shift. That's first thing. Second thing, just don't use them, right? So screens like this one right here is emitting lots of different types of light, but that blue light in particular that's coming out of the screen is suppressing melatonin production. Also, create a nice, relaxing evening routine. It can also really help with sleep. And set yourself up for success. If you know that you have to get up at 5 a.m. in the morning, for whatever reason, don't go to bed at 11, right? You may think, okay, 11 to 5, that's 6 hours of sleep. It's not 6 hours of sleep. It takes a little bit of time to fall into sleep. There are going to be wakeful periods in the night. That's normal. Most of the time, you're not even consciously aware of those times. So if you're going 11 to 5, you're probably getting more like 5.5 hours of sleep, not 6. So set yourself up for success by going to bed at a reasonable time. All right, so we're still on how you renew. Sleep is important. Also is getting good relaxation during your day. So the main researcher in this, or a main researcher in this, is Jon Kabat-Zinn. He's at the University of Massachusetts Medical Center, and he developed a system of mindfulness called mindfulness-based stress reduction. It's an 8-week program. There's actually people in Portland doing it here. I think OHSU has a group. There's another independent, it's called MBSR, provider. What it does is it combines mindfulness meditation and yoga. And so here's a website, mbsrportland.com, that tells you a little bit more information. So the health benefits of doing some sort of mindfulness practice includes increasing telomerase activity. So telomerase is actually what the enzyme that adds telomeres onto your DNA. So it's a good thing. So it does this in women with breast cancer. It decreases markers of stress, such as cortisol, right? So that stress hormone that's released from the adrenal glands. It improves mood, alleviates depression and anxiety, and alleviates distress from hot flashes. So for all you ladies out there, this can really help, actually. There's many ways to do mindfulness practices. This is just the most researched one. If you are into yoga, that's a really good thing to do to get that mindfulness. If you're really into Qigong, that's a great way to do it. Doing a mindful walk through the forest is a really good way. If you're a person of faith, reading the Bible and doing reflections on Bible verses is a really good way. There's lots of avenues to getting this reaction in the body. So I'd actually like to guide you all through a little bit of a relaxation right now. So I'd like you to sit comfortably in your chair. Uncross your legs. Feel the chair beneath you. And you can close your eyes or soften your gaze and draw your awareness inwards, focusing on your breath. Don't change it, just notice. Feeling your chest and your ribs expand as you inhale and relax as you exhale. Maybe you can feel your heart beating in your chest as you breathe. Feel your feet touching the ground. Feel your hands against your lap, crossed in front of you. And take a moment to slowly increase the length of each breath. Inhaling. And exhaling. Feeling the pause at the top of your breath. And the pause at the bottom of your breath. And when you're ready, slowly open your eyes and bring your awareness back into the room. So a mindfulness practice can be as simple as that. It doesn't need to be complicated. There don't need to be fancy words associated with it. Just drawing your awareness back into your body and really slowing and deepening the breath. You know, we've got in our nervous system, we've got the conscious, what's under conscious control, and we've got what's under unconscious control. So that's the parasympathetic nervous system. So the sympathetic versus parasympathetic, rest, digest versus fight or flight, right? And so most of our days, living day to day, we're in this fight or flight stressed state, right? We like to be in this parasympathetic rest and digest. So drawing blood inwards to the center so we can digest our food. We relax in that state. And interestingly, one of the only mechanisms in our body that's under both conscious and unconscious control is our breath. So we can switch that part of the nervous system, that part of the unconscious nervous system, by deliberately slowing our breath. Another nice thing to do, even if you don't like trees, is spend time in nature. In Japan, they call this nature bathing. I prescribe it every day. The health benefits, these are all studies with humans. Spending time in nature, and it doesn't have to be, you know, making a grand journey into the gorge. You know, it can be in your backyard, it can be sitting on your deck, enjoying a meal with your spouse or your kids. It can be looking out a window while you're reading a book. Some of the data is even at looking at pictures of nature. But the health benefits include decreases stress, improves mood, enhances cognitive function. That's nice, right? Who couldn't use a couple extra marbles up there as we age? Improves surgical recovery time. That's really interesting, right? So just having a hospital room with a window facing outwards allows your body to heal more rapidly so you can actually go home quicker. And that's why most modern hospitals don't have windows facing inwards anymore, right? They don't face into a courtyard. They almost always face outwards. Decreases overall morbidity. It's not up here, but it also improves immune function. So it increases natural killer cell activity, which is pretty cool. Like I said, it doesn't need to be in the forest. Gardens, neighborhood parks, natural features in a city all count, right? So if you are finding yourself working in a cubicle or you're, mall walking in the winter, get outside. Put on a raincoat. Walk outside. Make sure you're getting some sort of green environment every day. All right, so how you move, as important as how you renew. All of these are equally important. We know that exercise is not just about your waist size, though weight management is also important. We know that BMI or the weight does influence telomere length. But regular physical activity decreases cardiovascular diseases like heart attacks, strokes, and heart failure. It improves cognitive function and lowers dementia risk. Lowers depression rates, improves bone mineral density, and decreases osteoporosis. Improves sleep quality. So if you're really struggling in that first category, that sleep quality thing, get moving during the day. That can improve sleep quality. And decreases overall mortality by 30%. That's not a small number. I mean, that's bigger than most of the medications that we give people. This is not heroic efforts we're talking about here. So this is 30 to 60 minutes of intentional physical activity every day. If you can't get 30 to 60 minutes one day, it's just really not going to happen. Anything is better than nothing. So just because you can't get to the gym, it just seems like too much, don't let that stop you from doing 5 minutes down your street and back. Any and all exercise counts. So brisk walks, you get bonus points if you go with friends, and I'll explain that as we get to the engage section. Extra bonus points if it's at a park, because then you get the nature thing going on. That right there, that's three categories: rest, renew, engage, and how you eat. That's everything. Brisk walk, so that's exercise, engaging with a friend, renewing at a park, finish that off with like a nice lunch with your friend. You've got all four categories in one event. Gardening can be really good work, especially this season when we're doing a lot of pruning. It's a lot of work. Swimming and water aerobics, yoga, tai chi, or qigong, weightlifting or resistance training. Dancing, that's a really good one. Things that can help you get moving. So if you really like going to the gym, that's just your thing, keep a packed gym bag in your car at all times. So if the moment strikes you, you can just go right there and you don't have to worry about, oh, I don't have my shoes. Oh, I don't have my pants. It's just all right there. Fitness trackers that buzz after a period of inactivity, that can also be helpful. So if you're still working, having that just sort of buzzes you and says, hey, get up, you need to do 48 more steps before 2 o'clock. That can be really helpful. Schedule activities. You may not feel like exercising in the moment, but I can guarantee you, if you've arranged with Sally down the street that you're gonna go for a walk next Wednesday at 9 a.m., I'll meet you at the corner, you're both gonna show up, right? So having that accountability to friends and or I call it a fitness buddy, can be really, really helpful. And again, fit it in when you can. 5 minutes six times a day is as effective as 30 minutes straight. So when I'm at work, I'm going patient, patient, patient. I visit my son, then I come back and I go patient, 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 patient. Between patients, I do stair laps, right? It takes me 4 minutes, up and down. I do that between patients. That's what I do when I can't get out. All right, how you eat, very important. So probably the best studied diet for overall longevity and overall wellness is the Mediterranean diet. So this is the Mediterranean diet pyramid that was put together by the Old Ways Preservation. They're a great resource. So if you ever find yourself on the internet, preferably not after 9 p.m., because you should not be on your screens, preferably in the morning. But should you find yourself on the internet, that's a great resource. So at the bottom, which is important in this diet, is actually not food at all. It's engagement with others, enjoying your food with others, and being physically active, right? That's the foundation. And then the vast majority of the food that you consume should be fresh fruits and vegetables and whole grains, lots of fish and seafood. Poultry, eggs, cheese, and yogurt are still in the diet, just not as frequently. And then meats and sweets are up at the top. And notice there is wine there, red, but it's there. So Mediterranean diet. And this is primarily the style of eating that those folks in Icaria were eating. So high intake of plants, that includes veggies, fruits, beans. We don't eat enough beans in this environment. So legumes of any sort. So that includes lentils, garbanzo beans or hummus, black beans, black-eyed peas. Also includes soy. Whole soy foods like tofu, tempeh, miso, edamame, they're fabulous. Don't be afraid of them. High intake of extra virgin olive oil, right? So here's a little snippet about extra virgin olive oil. A lot of imported olive oil is actually not olive oil, okay? So back in the 80s and 90s into the early 2000s, the Italian government clamped down really hard on the Italian mafia. And so they weren't doing so much trading in guns and drugs. So they turned to the olive oil market. So they really clamped down on that market. And so a lot of actually what's being imported right now is being cut with other types of oils, unfortunately. Yeah. So there's, I'll tell you a couple brands that consumerlabs.org, which is a great organization. It's a nonprofit that basically goes through supplements and products and tests them to make sure that they are what they say they are. Because there's very little regulation in the supplement industry in this country. They've done olive oil, and they found two brands that were really up to snuff. One is California Olive Ranch. You can find it at Fred Meyer's. You can pretty much find it anywhere. Olive Ranch. California Olive Ranch. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a great one. Also, Kirkland's Organic Extra Virgin Olive Oil seems to be pretty good. We also live in the Willamette Valley, where we have lots of olive growers here. So you can get local, organic, beautiful olive oil straight here. Generally speaking, domestic is going to be a little bit more reliable than imported. So if you get Californian extra virgin olive oil, you're probably doing pretty well. Moderately high intake of fish, any and all. We all think about salmon. Salmon's big here. We're in the Pacific Northwest, but that's not the only fish. There's lots of other types of fish. Moderate intake of dairy, especially those cultured dairy like yogurt, kefir, cheese, so those aged cheeses. A moderate intake of meat, poultry, and eggs. Water is the primary fluid, and not water-like substances. Water. There's a difference. A moderate consumption of wine, generally with meals and generally shared with friends. So moderate consumption means 1 to 2 glasses, no more. So with the Mediterranean diet, we see less overall mortality, less obesity, less heart disease and stroke, less type 2 diabetes, less cancer, improved brain function, less neurodegenerative disease like Parkinson's, less depression, less menopausal symptoms like hot flashes and night sweats, and longer telomeres. So basically, less of all the bad stuff, more of all the good stuff. It's a Whole Foods Mediterranean diet. So have any of you guys been to Whole Foods and seen like the paleo snack bars? I find that very humorous because, you know, a lot of these diets, kind of doesn't even matter what it is. In its unadulterated form, really what they're saying is eat real food, right? Paleo, ketogenic, Mediterranean, I mean, you name it. They're talking about real food. And then our wonderful economy gets to it and businesses create food-like substances that adhere to the diet, right? Because we all want easy, right? So avoid that. So Mediterranean diet is unrefined, right? The less ingredients in that ingredient label, the better. So aim for 9 servings of vegetables and whole fruits per day. That's a lot more than the 1.8 that Oregonians are consuming right now. So 1 serving equals 1/2 cup cooked or 1 cup raw vegetable or fruit. French fries do not count. Sorry. Avoid juice and eat the whole fruit and vegetables instead. So we all think like juicing, super healthy, right? I've got my wheatgrass, I've got my celery, I've got my apple. You are losing all of the fiber and you are basically getting vitamin sugar water. It's tasty. It's tasty vitamin sugar water, but it's still vitamin sugar water. So if you're going to go for some prune juice, eat prunes instead. Right? If you're going to go for apple juice, eat an apple. If you really, really want your vegetable drink, make it as a smoothie so at least you retain that fiber in there, which slows down the glycemic impact of that food, meaning it spikes your blood sugar less. So eat plenty of beans and legumes and also include raw nuts and seeds. Any and all, don't care. Peanuts, walnuts, almonds, cashews, sunflower seeds, chia seeds, flax seeds. They're all good. Don't worry about this like, oh, walnuts are higher in omega-3s and oh, flax seeds, the superfood. Those things are true, but they're all good for you. eat intact or minimally processed whole grains like brown rice, oat groats. Does anyone know what oat groats are? Basically oats before you grind them. So steel cut oats, you just basically chop them. In the slow cook oats or even instant oats, they basically just steamroll them, right? So oat groats are before that process happens. They look a lot, oat groats look a lot like rice. Steel cut oats are still pretty good. Quinoa, millet, and barley. The whole barley, not the pearled barley. Basically, if you wonder what whole grain options there are, we have a wonderful thing called Bob's Red Mill right across the river. It's a great place to go and just sort of look to see what options there are. And basically, you cook whole grains like you cook whole grains. They all cook basically the same, 1 cup of the grain to 2 cups water, approximately. Eat good fat with each meal and a snack. So good fats are avocados, raw nuts, raw seeds, using extra virgin olive oil as the main kitchen oil. Eat plenty of fish. I mean, the salmon's great, but so is tuna. Sardines are fabulous. They're great with the omega-3s. Also include unprocessed and uncured meat, poultry, dairy, and real eggs. We already talked about the yogurt. So this is not a low-fat diet. I know a lot of us grew up in this environment where it was low-fat, low-fat, fat's going to kill you, fat is going to cause heart disease and stroke. That is not the case. Turns out it's a lot more about quality of fat and having a diet that's really rich in high-quality omega-3 polyunsaturated fats and monounsaturated fats like those found in avocados, olive oil, nuts and seeds. That's actually good for you. It can lower bad cholesterol, raise good cholesterol, and it also is very satisfying. It often is what gives food that umami flavor, so it's very satisfying and filling. So minimize added sugar. So no more than 25 grams or 6 teaspoons of added sugar. Honey and maple syrup count, even though they're natural. So that sounds like a lot, 6 teaspoons. Like, have you actually measured that out? Sounds like a lot. A Coke. Does anyone want to look that one up? I think it's something like 50 teaspoons. It's something insane. It's just a massive quantity of sugar. So yogurt, that's a good food, right? I talked about cultured yogurt. So here are 2 yogurts that we find at most stores. And I'm not meaning to advocate for one brand over another. This is just, you know, Danone has lots of good yogurts, actually. And Faye has some not so great yogurts. But on the left, that is Danone's vanilla yogurt, and it's written small, but that has 33 grams of sugar per serving. It's a lot of sugar, right? And then if you add your fruit, that's more sugar. It's natural. Like, so fruit counted in the sugar in fruit is actually pretty okay because we've got that fiber to slow down the absorption. But 33 grams of sugar plus your fruit, plus maybe you mix in some granola that's sweetened with honey or maple syrup, suddenly you're in, like, Häagen-Dazs territory. Right? So you might as well be eating that piece of cake for breakfast, honestly, where you think you're, like, doing great. So Faye Total, this is whole fat, plain Greek yogurt, has 8 grams of sugar. Still has sugar. Anything with milk or dairy is going to have sugar. Lactose is the sugar found in dairy products, and it's naturally occurring. But it doesn't have any added sugar, whereas with the Danone product, because it's the vanilla-flavored kind, sugar is the number 2 ingredient. So with yogurts, I say somewhere between 7 and 10 grams of sugar in your yogurt is probably naturally occurring. Anything beyond that is not something that you want to be purchasing. So just look at the label at the grocery store and just choose the one that has lower sugar. Generally speaking, you want to avoid flavored yogurts. Stick with the plain, add your own flavoring. So then at least if you're adding sugar, you're doing it consciously. You can measure it out and really know exactly how much you're getting, as opposed to essentially 7 teaspoons for breakfast and then you're shot for the rest of the day. So the question was non-fat or fat. I prefer whole fat organic yogurt if you can swing it. Tends to lower the sugar content and actually increase that satiety feeling. And again, fat's not the demon here anymore. So I say go whole fat and be satisfied, unless you really like non-fat, in which case that's fine. Plain is really the more important thing. Here's another example. Oatmeal. They're both instant or quick cook. So they're both prepared basically the oats in the same way. They're both Quaker, right? So same brand. The one on the left is the maple and brown sugar. As you can imagine, it has lots of sugar in it. For this one, it's actually 14 grams per packet. And I don't know, maybe I'm just a hungry gal, but I'm never satisfied with 1 packet of instant oatmeal. I do more like 2 or 3. I don't know if you guys are like me or not, but. Whereas the one on the right, which is just 100% rolled oats, they roll it really thin to make it instant. So you do, in that thinning process, you lose a little bit more of the bran, which provides a lot of fat-soluble vitamins and fiber. So that's why I like the oat groats or steel cut better. But 0 sugars, right? So that's 14 grams of added sugar, you're more than halfway to your daily allotment just from that. Where you could easily just do quick cook oats, same amount of time, add fruit, right? Add some cinnamon, which is great because it has the feeling in the mouth of sweetness. But cinnamon as an herb actually stabilizes blood sugar without having any sugar in it. All right, so we're going to do a little Cosmo quiz here. So I'm going to ask you to keep track of this. I'm going to read it out for you. So this is the Mediterranean Diet Adherence Assessment. So you know how well you are doing right now and where you can improve. So this is the assessment that's been used in a lot of the large epidemiological or population studies looking at the Mediterranean diet as the main marker. So question one, do you use olive oil as your main culinary fat? You get a point if the answer is yes. Number two, how much olive oil do you consume in a given day, including oil used for frying, salads, out-of-house meals, etc.? If it is greater than 4 tablespoons, you get a point. That's a lot of oil. That's a lot of oil. Don't be afraid of using it, right? If you steam some broccoli, drizzle it on top at the end, right? If you're roasting cauliflower, all over that. How many vegetable servings do you consume per one day? So here they have one serving is 200 grams or 7 ounces. So if it's greater than 2, you get a point. Greater than or equal to 2. It's actually surprisingly not that. I said greater than 9. That's what I consider good. But they're saying greater than 2 vegetable servings per day. Granted, their 7-ounce serving is pretty large. You get a point there. How many fruit units, including natural fruit juices, I don't count that, but they do, do you consume per day? If it's greater than or equal to 3, you get a point. How many servings of red meat, hamburger, or meat products like ham, sausage, etc., do you consume per one day? If it's less than 1, so 1 doesn't count, an average of 1 per day, so 7 a week, you don't get a point. If it's less than that, so maybe every other day, every third day, you get a point there. How many servings of butter, margarine, or cream do you consume per day? If it's less than 1 there, you get a point. How many sweet or carbonated beverages do you drink per day? If you get less than 1, you get a point there. How much wine do you drink per week? If it's greater than or equal to 7, you get a point. I know, it's a little controversial, right? Yeah. How many servings of legumes do you consume per week? So this is your beans, lentils, things like that. If it's greater than or equal to 3, so probably at least half of your days, you get a point there. How many servings of fish or shellfish do you consume per week? If it's greater than or equal to 3, you get a point there. How many times per week do you consume commercial sweets or pastries? Not homemade, commercial. So if you're going to Starbucks and getting a pastry, something like that, cakes, cookies, biscuits, custard, if it's less than 3 times a week, you get a point. How many servings of nuts, including peanuts, do you consume per week? Greater than or equal to 3, so this is 1 ounce as a serving, you get a point there. Do you preferentially consume chicken, turkey, or rabbit meat instead of veal, pork, hamburger, or sausage? If you say yes, you get a point. How many times per week do you consume vegetables, pasta, rice, or other dishes seasoned with sofrito? So sofrito is a sauce made with tomatoes, onions, leeks, or garlic and simmered with olive oil. Sort of the foundation of a lot of Mediterranean cuisines. So if it's greater than or equal to 2 days a week, you get a point. So tally up your points. If you have more than 10 points, you are doing really well. Lower adherence is less than 7. So if you're less than 7, there's probably some areas where you could improve. I will say, taking the totality of dietary research, we know that the Mediterranean diet as a whole diet is sort of seems to be the best way to go. If you are not a drinker today, don't go home and start drinking because I told you to. If you do consume red wine on a really moderate basis, feel really good about that. If you're drinking more than 2 or 3, or if you're drinking more than 2 glasses a night, you will benefit from cutting down to 1 or 2. So the question is, why do you stick to olive oil if you don't like the taste of it? Well, the olive oil, because the olive oil has the best data behind it, honestly, we're talking about health outcomes, right? So you also have to consider enjoyment is an important thing. I always tell my patients that it's great to stick to either the 80-20 or the 90-10 rule, which 80 or 90% of what you consume in your body should be for your body's health. 10 to 20% should be for your spirit's health. And if your spirit really wants a Snickers once every other week, and that's your 10%, then by golly, enjoy that Snickers. Sit down and enjoy every bite of it, right? So we're talking about health outcomes, and by far, the health outcomes seem to be best with extra virgin olive oil. A lot of people say the same thing. I don't like vegetables. I hear that all the time. Don't like vegetables. A lot of times, it's about how it's prepared. Okay, so ultimately, what's most important? when it comes to diet. Eat food. I stole this from Michael Pollan, by the way. He came to speak. I'm not sure if any of you saw him after he wrote his book, Cooked. It's a great book. He's a journalist. He himself is not a researcher outside of his journalism. He's not a dietitian, but he does write about food in a really, really eloquent way. And he wrote a book called Food Rules. So these three rules are from that book. So eat food. Real food, right? So something that your great-great-grandmother would recognize and know what to do with. So this go-go-go-gurts or, you know, these cookie-like substances or low-cal, 100-cal option things with lots of packaging, that's not real food, right? So eat food, right? Fewer ingredients on the label, the better. The best food doesn't need an ingredient list, right? Shop the periphery of the grocery store. Fill your cart with produce first. Shop the bulk section. Most of your food should be vegetables. And eat in moderation, not too much. If that's all you can stick to, you are doing leaps and bounds better than the vast majority of Americans. So if you find that you, maybe in that questionnaire, you were maybe at like 4 points, 5 points, some room for improvement, where to start, right? Or maybe you grew up in the Midwest or you grew up here and you're just sort of a meat and potatoes kind of person, right? I don't like vegetables. Where do you start from there? So the first thing to do is not take away that steak. It's to add things in. That's going to make it more sustainable for you. And ultimately, you want to shift the way that you eat for the rest of your life and not feel deprived. So add foods rather than take them away. Replace all fats with extra virgin olive oil. I say except for high heat cooking. So extra virgin olive oil does have a fairly low smoke point. I still saute with it on the stove. Actually, it's pretty hard to get it to smoke. If you set the oil on the stove and it starts smoking, don't use it. But you have to do sort of like high heat stir frying to be of really much any concern. And in that case, for me personally, I use avocado oil. It's another high monounsaturated fat, minimally processed fat that looks biochemically more similar to olive oil and some other things. Add things to foods, right? So if you're cooking with rice, add that jar of tomatoes, add some olive oil, add culinary spices like rosemary or garlic. Right? So if, again, like that broccoli analogy, if you're steaming broccoli, drizzle it with olive oil, right? Saute some onions with that and garlic. So use smaller amounts of good quality meats to flavor legumes and or soups for meat dominant eaters. So if you are like the meat and potatoes person, don't eliminate it, right? Just do a stew instead, like a tomato-based stew. Chop up the meat so that one serving of meat is now spread between maybe three meals. Always make leftovers. So it's really, when you're starting to change dietary habits, it's really hard to think of new recipes all the time. So just plan on leftovers. Cook like you're cooking for a family of six. Stick things in the freezer in individual servings, pull them out when you're ready. That'll give you some time to build up your new cooking repertoire. And how you eat is as important as what you eat. So if you remember back at that pyramid that we looked at the beginning of the food section, that base was enjoying meals with others, moving your body. Enjoy your meals with friends, right? If you live alone, Set dates to meet with friends or family for meals on a regular basis. Cook your own meals. So the moment you consume food outside of the house, even if it's at, you know, a wonderful restaurant, they're probably going to be adding things that you don't want them to add, like lots of extra salt, different types of foods. You know, it just, there's a lot less control over the process. And digestion starts with cooking, right? So as you're smelling the foods, that stimulates saliva. Saliva contains amylase, which is an enzyme that breaks down carbohydrates. It gets you into a relaxation state so that the body is ready to receive food and you don't feel super bloated after you eat. Minimize distractions while eating. So turn the TV off. Turn your phone. I'm telling my husband all the time, like, stop looking at your phone. We're enjoying a family meal right now. Still working on that one. Chew your foods thoroughly, right? Digestion starts in the mouth with those enzymes. Then it continues in the stomach. It also allows the brain to catch up with the stomach. So the stretch fibers in the stomach that tell your body when it's full take some time to fill up, tell the brain to release the hormones of satiety or feeling of fullness. So chew your foods thoroughly. Give your body time to feel that sense of fullness. And then how you engage. So I think this is one that we often don't think about as a health marker, but it is probably one of the, you know, they're all important, but this is a really important one. So social isolation is implicated in a myriad of disease states and shortens lifespan. In this study, this is pretty amazing. Social isolation is as impactful on your health as smoking. Like chronic daily smoker, it's as impactful. It seems to be more important in overall longevity than weight, right? So you can be obese as long as you're getting out with friends. You're doing okay. Still important to have a healthy weight. But social engagement seems to be more important than your weight or activity level. That's amazing. So inflammation caused by chronic stress is likely the avenue that isolation exerts its effect. So we know that individuals that are socially isolated tends to have higher rates of depression. Depression causes inflammation. We also, when we're socially engaged, we build out our social support network so that when things do happen to us, we have somebody to call, right? So especially if you're living alone or your family's really far away, you know, hospitalizations are gonna happen, right? Illnesses are gonna happen. If you've got the flu and you're bedridden for a week, who's gonna make your soup, right? Who's gonna walk the dog? You know, having that social network of people that you can actually call on to do that is really important. And it actually, this is interesting, stronger social support networks, both formal and informal. So formal social support networks would include church groups, civic groups, things where you have like a formal title. Informal is just sort of your friend network. So stronger social support is associated with increased independence and greater ability to perform activities of daily living. So activities of daily living are, can you get yourself dressed? Can you bathe yourself? Can you prepare your own meals? Can you go shopping? Can you drive your car? So just having that stronger social network allows people to live independently longer. And I don't know anyone who's like, please sign me up for the nursing home, right? We all want to be able to age in place. And there's a huge movement in the nursing community about how to help people age in place. And this is a piece of it, just staying engaged. So social engagement includes lots of different avenues. So if you don't have a strong friend network, that's okay. Your spouse or committed life partner, roommates. There's a lot of people right now in the retired community that are choosing to have roommates, even if they don't financially need to have roommates. For this reason, just to stay engaged. Family, both nuclear and extended, friends, a spiritual or faith community. There's tons of opportunities in faith communities for social engagement. Volunteer organizations, right? There's so many people in need here in the community, and find your passion, Google the organization that does it, because Google knows everything, and call them. Just say, hey, I don't know what I can do for you, but I've got time and energy, and I'd love to help out, right? I can guarantee you any nonprofit in this city would leap at the opportunity to find something for you to do. There's lots of support groups. So a lot of the health organizations like Providence, OHSU, Legacy, they have really great support groups for all sorts of reasons. Caregivers of individuals with cancer, individuals suffering from different types of diseases, all sorts of things. Coworkers can be a good support network as well. Sports teams. I'm a rower. So, you know, I get some of my social support outside of my work and my immediate friends from getting up at 4:30 in the morning. I'm not doing it right now. I've got a baby. But in the future, I'll go back to that. And rowing with other women, you know, and watching the sunrise over the Willamette. It's a wonderful way to engage socially. And I'm not a natural extrovert. So it's a way for me to engage where I'm not actually having to talk with people. It's nice. Just the right amount of talking with people. So sports teams. Strangers. Surprisingly, there's studies looking at people that are just engaging with people at Starbucks, at the library, at, you know, wherever they're going, at the gas station, and just having a human exchange outside of, yes, I'd like my latte, 16-ounce latte, please. You know, and saying, hey, how's your day going? Or, oh, isn't this weather wild that we're having today? You know, that starts a conversation and it perpetuates itself. It makes you feel connected to your community. Another thing with how we engage is finding humor in things. So laughing, the act of laughing, changes our immune system, right? Decreases the risk of dying from infection by around 75% in this one study. That's wild. Laughing, right? So the thing that I do whenever I get sick is I watch sitcoms all day long. All day long. I just laugh all day long. I think it helps. Finding humor in things may help us live longer, even in the face of really serious disease. And in my position, I'm dealing with people with stage 4 cancer every single day. And if those people are able to find humor, I can tell you that it decreases their pain levels. It makes them feel more engaged with their communities. It makes them feel less despondent about where they're at. And it gives them hope. So a study of individuals with end-stage kidney disease had a 31% increased chance of survival when they had a good sense of humor. Now, I'm not sure how they measured this sense of humor, but that's pretty phenomenal. And in this other study, a high scores on sense of humor decreases the risk of dying from all causes by nearly 50% in women. Pretty powerful. So find whatever you like, joke telling, laughing with friends. You know, if you look at actually primate studies, it's really interesting is that when primates are engaging with each other, one of the signs of them communicating, you are part of our tribe, is laughing, right? And we do that too. If you look at human, more anthropological studies, laughter with individuals, even if it's not at a joke, is a communication, a method of communication that tells the person that you're with, you are part of my circle. Right, so if you want to expand your circle, laugh with people, right? Because you're telling them like, hey, you're my tribe, right? It's helpful. So create opportunities to laugh. Watch the funny movie or TV show. Go to a comedy club. We've got great ones here. Read the funny pages. Seek out funny people. Share a good joke or a funny story. Check out your bookstore's humor section. I should have put library, I apologize. Library's humor section. Host a game night with friends. There's tons of fun, charades, you know? That's a good Pictionary. I mean, there's tons of fun party games that you can play. Play with a pet. Dogs are hilarious. They do hilarious things. Go to a laughter yoga class. Have you guys ever seen videos of this or been to a laughter yoga class? It's a riot. So basically the idea, it doesn't really look like yoga, but it is a yoga, is you get a group together and they basically just start laughing, right? And there's like these different laughter exercises, so they might go, ho, 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 hee, 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 hee. And you go on like this for like an hour, and eventually, I mean, you get these waves of true laughter, like true belly laughter out of these basically physical abdominal exercises. It's great. Goof around with kids. You know, if you're looking to laugh, find a toddler who's not having a meltdown. Even the meltdowns are kind of funny. So give around with kids. You know, if you're looking for a volunteer opportunity, volunteer, you know, at a YMCA or, you know, another type of opportunity that gets you engaged with young kids. Because you'll definitely laugh. All right. I love this. This is Mark Twain in Following the Equator. Wrinkles should merely indicate where the smiles have been. All right. How do we create success? We've talked about a lot tonight. How to change what you're doing right now in your day-to-day to promote longevity and wellness. How do we actually make those changes? So understand why you want to change. That harkens back to that very first slide where what does living well mean to you? So find whatever that is in you and really focus on doing that fully and making sure that any barriers that are in your way to doing whatever living a full life means to you is addressed. Have a plan. Don't just wake up tomorrow and say, oh, I'm going to eat the Mediterranean diet today. Have a plan. So eat through your kitchen first, right? Make a meal plan. Make a list for the grocery store. Go to the grocery store. Come back. Make sure you have time set up in your day to cook these meals. If you have a setback, and you will have setbacks, don't dwell on them, right? Weddings happen. Cake happens. Bad days happen, right? Depression happens. It's okay. Don't dwell on that and get yourself stuck in this downward spiral because I've seen that happen to a lot of people. Each day is a new day. Practice positive self-talk. So what can I say to myself? Instead of thinking, I'm not good at this, try thinking, what am I missing? Instead of saying, I'm awesome at this, say, I'm on the right track. This is actually interesting. If you look at motivation and grit development, especially the research is in kids primarily, kids that think that they are just innately great at something, when they hit setback, which they inevitably will, they end up giving up. So individuals that have the perception of this is hard, I need to work at it, and value the energy and expenditure of energy on achieving a goal rather than the goal itself. They tend to have more tenacity and achieve what they actually want to achieve. So I'm a big fan of not just I'm awesome at this, because it takes away the opportunity for you to grow. So I'm on the right track. I give up. Instead of that, say, I'll use some of the strategies we've learned. This is too hard. Instead, say, this may take some time and effort. So there's lots of ways to switch those feelings into more positive self-talk. And that takes practice. And that is all I have for you today. This is where our team is located. I'm at the Zeidel Center for Integrative Medicine on our West Side location at St. Vincent Hospital, myself and Dr. Laura Martell. We have other providers at the Bradley Stuveland Integrative Medicine Facility on the east side at Providence, Portland. All right. Well, thank you all so much for joining me tonight. Have a great night.